Hi, AJ Hartley here, novelist, Shakespeare professor, fan of lots of stuff. I'm actually at Dragon Con this weekend, but I wanted to make a little headway on a video I've been thinking about making for a couple of weeks. It's in response to the new Glimspanky album, Into the Time Hole, which for some reason I'm finding very hard to actually get hold of as a physical copy. Every time I try on Amazon in Japan, it seems to be unavailable. I'm not sure why. So at the moment, I'm relying on streaming services and YouTube. But I wanted to talk about, I don't know if it's technically a single. I guess it's a single. I don't really understand what singles are anymore. It used to make a difference, right? When an actual little 7-inch piece of vinyl came out. Now I'm not really sure what constitutes a single anymore. Anyway, they have released a new music video for this song, which I'm about to talk about, Shignaru wa Iranai, which means I don't need a signal, or we don't need a signal, but we'll talk about that. Song's great, and let's get into it. Oh, what a great kickoff, right? Last time I did a Glimspanky video, somebody pointed out that I didn't really talk about the guitar work. So let's give some props to Hiroki Kamemoto for that kick-ass intro. And it's just the guitar, right? And a simple drum. There's no other instruments in it. And it's got that rawness, that real sort of, again, that retro Glimspanky sound that throws us right into the song. And I think that the retro quality of the sound absolutely speaks to what the song is about. The new album is called Into the Time Hole, and as I've said before, it's a great title and a great concept for a band like Glimspanky, who are all about trying to sort of use late 60s, 70s sounds to create new music. And there's something very sort of analog about the way that they function, and I think you hear that right away. And I think maybe the band is also conscious that, you know, so much of what people associate with Glimspanky is about Remy's voice. Which is understandable, but the extent to which they rely on this guitar sound can't be overstated, I think. And so I think it makes perfect sense that the name of the band comes up with just him to sort of set that scene. And we've only got glimpses of her in that really kind of spooky way where we can see her, that sort of ghostly presence in the background, but her features sort of vanish, which I think is really interesting. How great is that voice? Again, it's always surprising, right? You always expect something in a higher register and it comes up and it's got that sort of deep power. Remy brings that sort of force to it, which I love. And the lyric, I think, you know, right from the start, sort of sets up what the song is about. Kajikamu kokoro o atatame arunana araso koto wa nai. So if we can warm each other's aching hearts, then there's no need to fight. So it immediately creates this thing about the capacity of people to nurture each other, to cheer each other up, to make each other feel better. And in this sort of very physical, immediate way, right? We can do this. And the implication is kind of in person, right? Through direct connection, we can make people feel better. So there's no need to fight. If we can do that, then there shouldn't be a problem, right? What's the nature of the problem? Itetsuku roji de bakemono ga warateru. So in this sort of freezing or frozen alleyway, there's a monster, bakemono, is laughing at us. So we have the capacity to connect with people, to move people, to make them feel good about themselves. But there's this sense of something out there in the cold, this monstrous presence which is making fun of us. Now, the next line, Utori ni shiroto, it wants me to, it's telling me to do what it wants. It's telling me to do as it says. And I think that what we're talking about here is the difference between the real and the cyber. I mean, it's not limited to that exclusively, but I think that the song positions this as being about actual connection and communication and individual choice and how we're going to live and how we're going to behave in the context of peer pressure and internet culture, which are sort of exerting a force on us, trying to sort of push us in a certain kind of direction. It's not exclusively that, but this is the way that it resonates, particularly for me, given some of the other references in the song. So I think there's this sense that there's this force out there, the monster, which is cold and mocking. But I think it's registered increasingly in the song as a kind of digital presence, as part of this sort of online community. And that's the signal that we don't need. That's what the title of the song means, right? And then this next line, which is, there's a number of tricky lines in this song that I've had to sort of talk to other people about. Kaigoroshi no yume ga naite iru. Kaigoroshi. So, you know, I've looked at a number of online translations of this, you know, sort of machine translations, and it's like the tamed dreams or the dreams of the tamed people are crying. But kaigoroshi is a very specific and curious word associated particularly with businesses in Japan, with employers. And it's a process by which a person is employed but is kept in such a situation that they are unable to show or utilize their skills or capacity. And as in sense, their talent or capability is being killed. Now, this is a phrase that also gets applied to family relationships, to romantic relationships, a sense of unfulfilled potential. This is what that taming means, the sort of the limits of people sort of weeping because they are unable to live out their potential. And this is the sort of mantra of this song. It keeps coming up. And so again, I think that some of this is this sense of being limited by external pressures, right? That our capacity as individuals, as artists, right? I think there's an autobiographical element to this song for Glimspanky, that there's a sense that if we conform to what people want of us, and again, often that pressure is coming from online sources, we're limited, right? We're forced to go along in a certain kind of direction, and we don't get to really behave as artists. And I think this speaks to Glimspanky's status as a kind of indie band who have resisted mainstream conventional sound. But I think it also speaks to their retro style, right? The refusal to sort of buy into a very sort of digitized notion of where contemporary music is going, particularly pop music, and sort of to resist that, to say our artistic integrity in some ways requires us to not listen to that pressure from outside. And as that first line says, doesn't mean that we can't connect with people, doesn't mean that we can't make people feel better. That's exactly what we're doing. And we would lose that if we give in to the kind of conformist impulse that comes from outside. And the song ratchets up here in pitch and volume, and then we get the force of the song, of the lyric. De tarame ni odorasa reteru sekai de Ashimoto bakari kini shite ita nja. In a world where everybody's sort of dancing stupidly, randomly, so a lot of nonsense, all you care about is where you put your feet or where you stand. It's a great image, right? That with all this sort of chaos, yet you spend all your time trying not to screw up, trying not to put your foot in it. But in the world, particularly in the online world, this is an incredibly difficult thing to do, because the rules keep changing, so that everybody's sort of dancing around, but you're sort of forced to follow suit, and it's like sort of picking your way through a minefield. You never know what's going to blow up. Everybody's stupid. They're all fools. And the reason is that she then goes on to say, "Mabata ki no tabini kawaru sekaini." So the right answer is constantly, it changes like in the blink of an eye. And again, I think that this sense that in the online world, the internet world, everything moves so quickly, and what is considered acceptable is a sort of constantly moving target. As culture, it continues to evolve at this breakneck pace, and through the internet particularly, it communicates itself all the time. So that in the past, when things changed within society, it took time for those changes to sort of permeate out. But now you've got a sort of a spearhead through Twitter or TikTok or whatever, which is constantly leading various charges as the culture sort of breaks up, disseminates, fragments, improves, goes backwards, but it creates this sort of constant movement and constant online noise, right? Where even when you're trying to play it safe, even when you're trying to say the right thing, the rules keep changing. The goalposts are constantly being moved, so that if you're not paying really, really close attention all the time, something that you say or do is already obsolete, has already managed to cause offense, is already like, oh, that's so 2 years ago or whatever. It didn't used to be this way because we didn't have the technology to create the sort of sense of what is considered acceptable and normal communication in this moment, until we had this means of disseminating these cultural positions, right? So the sense that even the right answer is constantly changing. So people spend their lives living on the internet to try and keep up with whatever's going on. We talk about that fear of missing out, right? That it's more than that. It's not just that, because that sounds like, oh, it's all positive. But it's not just all positive. We're also fear of saying something or doing something which is out of step, because we didn't know that certain things have changed within the last few weeks or days or hours, right? Furi mawasa renakute iyo na. You don't need to be swayed by or pressured by the right answer, which changes every time you look away from it, right? So there's no point looking for that signal, right? Signal is the word that runs all the way through the song. It's like a traffic light or something like that. There's no point constantly waiting for that signal, because the signal's always changing. What is considered the right answer is in a constant state of flux. Dare kaga hanata shigu naru wa iranai. So I don't need a signal sent hanata from somebody else. Dare ka, some random people. We don't even know who they are. People who are sending these signals, that's the same signal that I don't need. Iranai, right? That's not helpful to me. Should add maybe that the use of the word signal here is something, traditionally in Japan it's applied to traffic lights and all kinds of other things. It's a fairly general use. But I'm told that it has a somewhat negative connotation with younger people these days, in specific regard to the internet. That may be one person's opinion, but I thought it was worth mentioning. And apparently there's also a manga and movie called Signal 100, which is about high school students who are killed when they involuntarily respond to a particular signal. So again, this idea of metaphorically of something being sort of broadcast out to you that you receive and it has a negative association apparently is sort of in the zeitgeist at the moment in Japan. After the rousing chorus, it comes back down, becomes a little bit more introspective as the shift becomes more about the individual person, right? That she's saying, you know, the more strange or twisted or distorted something is, the more I'm attracted to it, but I'm incapable of being honest. I can't sort of speak my mind, right? Again, because of this anxiety that we already discussed about putting your foot wrong, saying the wrong thing. Yokeina yoko ni so so nakasare. I'm sort of seduced by a superfluous, an unnecessary greed, acquisitiveness, a desire to get things. So you know, I think maybe one of the issues also about the internet is that it's constantly projecting things onto us that make us want things that we don't really want. I've talked about this before on this channel. It presents us with versions of the world and stuff that makes us want to consume, but we're being manipulated into those things, right? Kame no tarenai mama dakara. Because I can't, take off my mask, or because the pressure itself is being somehow concealed. Maybe that's closer. So I can't reveal myself online, but there's also a sense of being sort of pushed by forces that are themselves masked, I think. I'm not sure about that. And then, Kainarishita yume ga naiteiru. The dream of those people who are not able to fulfill their potential is weeping. Again, my capacity to be myself and to do things has been sort of stripped away, reduced. Man, every time it steps up that notch, it's so great, right? Baken no kawa o hagi o au kono sekai de mikata bakari janakute mo ii no sa. Sorry, I'm reading Romaji rather than Hiragana. It's confusing. Confusing phrase. I talked to my esteemed colleague Masako Osako, also known as my Japanese mother-in-law, and her translation of this was that people commonly try to reveal the weaknesses or falseness about others by ripping off their stripping away their pretenses, their facades in this world. So it's understandable, it's okay, Inosan, if it turns out that some people are not your allies, right? Or not everybody's on the same side. My friend Suimatsu Michiko from Gunma University translated those lines as, in the world where we strip off each other's monstrous masks, it's okay to find you are not only surrounded by those who are on your side. So I think the sense is similar to what I was saying, but I just wanted to get an extra clarification. Thank you, Michiko. And again, this is about the internet world, right? And you see in the video, we're starting to see those images of the cell phone videos popping up all over the place. This sense that everybody, in some ways, is trying to tear down everybody else and trying to get under their skin, trying to reveal who they are or conceal who they are. And you're caught up in the same logic and doing the same thing. But at some point, you have to recognize that not everybody's going to like you. Not everybody's going to agree with you. And the problem is trying to maintain that the facade of being part of one sort of single community, which is just not really true. So at some point, it's liberating to say, you know what? We're not all going to be on the same side. People are going to disagree with me. People are not going to like what I have to say, and that's okay. Yeah? Dose bakana bokura. We're all idiots anyway. It's a great line. Dose bakana bokura. Bokura wa. It's interesting, and again, the use of bokura as a plural pronoun. My mother-in-law, when I showed her some of the lyrics, she said, "Oh, this is written and performed by a man, I assume, because of the use of the word boku." So this is one of those rare opportunities for me to say, "Ah, actually, no," that boku is becoming used increasingly in Japanese music, particularly by female singers and songwriters, as a kind of tough but gender-neutral pronoun. So, and then we're back to that same idea. Mabataki no tabi ni kawaru sekai ni. So again, the right answer changes with the blink of an eye. And then, Kobi woru ki nado nai kara. So I'm not trying to flatter you, or we don't. Again, no pronouns. So I'm not trying to flatter you, or we don't need to be flattered. We don't need to be constantly told that everything is great, that we and that we all agree and that we're all on the same page. Dareka ga hanatta shigunaru wa iranai. We don't need a signal from someone else, right? So again, the song is pushing for us to sort of take your stand. Stop worrying about everything that's going on around you. Stop trying to conform to what you see from other people and what you think other people want you to be or what they're telling you to be. Pick your fight, define yourself, and take your stand. How cool is that solo, right? And again, it has that sort of very retro sound. He's cranking the wah pedal or something equivalent thereof that gives it that sort of squeal, to gives it that edginess to it, which has a kind of, again, pre-digital kind of sound. So I think it's sort of perfectly in accord with the song. But more than anything else, it lends that visceral quality to the guitar, so it's not just the voice that's having to carry that sense of frustration. Yeah, the guitar is doing it too, and it's the wail, the crying that we've been talking about. That this is the sound trying to escape, the sound of their own creativity trying to escape. Yeah, great. And then there's this lovely coming down out of the solo, this lovely little reflective moment. Donnani isoide itemo, doshite ukurete shimo. If we're going so fast, how come we're always late, right? And it's back to that sense of everything changing in the blink of an eye, everything going by so fast on the internet that, you know, what's trendy today on TikTok is forgotten. You know, the Twitter message that has hundreds of thousands, millions of views, and then it utterly disappears the following day, right? So there's always a sense that we're always somehow behind the curve. Anani mugen to omotta jikan mo itsu demo ato no matsurida. And I didn't know this phrase. And again, I had to sort of pool my resources. And the line means something like, no, doesn't matter, no matter how much time we think we have, it's always too late. Literally, the Ato no Matsurira, it means the festival is already over, right? Matsuri, as Baby Metal fans will know, means festival. So no matter how much time we think we have, the festival's almost over, and I always over. And I think this is the point where the song starts to get quite existential, right? It's not just talking about the sort of frantic pace of the internet and the inability to keep up with it. There's also this sort of more general sense about your own mortality, that this is how we're living our lives, and before you know it, we're going to be done. Nobody lives forever. The time passes quickly, and so what we have to do, in the logic of the song, is ditch the unnecessary clutter in our lives, the internet stuff, the keeping up with everybody else, the participating in these sort of constant online squabbles and so on. You know, that none of this stuff finally matters. We need to reprioritize our lines. And yes, I realize the irony of saying this on a YouTube video. But yeah, I think, you know, in the course of the song, you know, a number of times you see all the phones in their faces. And every time the phones are in their faces, they're presenting themselves in this very external way, right? It's very public, very much conscious of their self outside. And then these are juxtaposed with the moments of them either in isolation or with the little cassette player, which he's curled up around the cassette player as an analog form that doesn't communicate with the rest of the world, and that moment is private and internal, you know, the way we used to listen to music just by ourselves, rather than as something that then has to be, you know, shared with everybody and discussed and argued about. And that sentiment concludes with this line about Doga o mi sugite mahi shita no ja. I can't use my brain if it has been sort of paralyzed, confused, overwhelmed by too many videos, right? That we're spending so much time, screen time, so much time sort of moving from overstimulated by digital media, and I can't use my mind to process what's important anymore. And then we get this lovely sort of distant reprise of the previous line that you can only just hear, right? About that, you know, if we're dancing around all the nonsense of the world, the only thing that you're trying to avoid is where you put your feet. But this time there's the Yosoku dekinai mirai fumikomu. We're sort of stepping, you know, back to the image of the feet, but stepping into some sort of unpredictable future, right? Something that we can't calculate. And you know, we're not in, so it's a way of saying we're not in control, I think, as we're sort of dancing around doing whatever the internet tells us, doing whatever the monster in the alleyway tells us to do. We're not in control of our own destiny, and we're sort of just meandering through the world without a sense of purpose. Konna bakana bokuwa. Right, so again, we're all idiots, we're such fools. And then we're back into the final chorus again, which is a repeat of what we had before about our sort of disguises being peeled away. We're not all on the same side. We don't have to be, and we're all idiots. Everything's changing in a blink of an eye, so there's no point paying attention to it. And we're not trying to sort of, what's the point of trying to sort of flatter each other? And then the sort of modified repeat line, Sonna shigunaru wa iranai. I, we, you, all of us, don't need that kind of signal, right? And then we finish with, the instrumental break to give it a nice sort of punctuation mark to drive home the point at the end. And the last image we get is of the cassette player. So I think in some ways it's about sort of reclaiming the private value of music, among other things, right? And trying to separate yourself from the rest of the world, and valuing the stuff that you value, standing for the stuff that you stand for, without feeling the need to chase every trend and be in accord with whatever everybody else is saying. So, you know, that's what the song's about, and I think it's what the band is about. So it's a great image for them, a great emblem of what they're about. And I think it's a terrific song. Obviously, what you should really do is listen to the actual song without me talking all the way through it, and so that you can feel that sort of the visceral build of the argument as you just listen to it without it being disrupted by some idiot in a hotel room. What else? Nothing, I think. I'm at Dragon Con, so I have a whole bunch of panels today that I got to go do. So I am going to leave you guys. I hope you found this interesting. Check out more of their Glimspanky stuff. I want to see them getting more support. I don't understand why I can't get a hold of a physical copy of the Into the Time Hole album, but hopefully that will change. I think they're great, and I hope you like them. Thanks, as ever, to my patrons. Please, you know, as I say from time to time, check out my Patreon page. Check out my books. This channel is not monetized. I don't make anything from it. But if you would buy one of my books, that would be great. All right, and I will talk to you soon. Cheers. Bye.